Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for Calvary, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Just meditate on Calvary tonight and worship Him for some time. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you for Calvary, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, you've won my heart, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus, hallelujah. Lord, your heart was pierced, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Father, we praise and thank you, Lord, for your sweet presence in this place. Lord, let that man of Calvary, Lord, really arrest our hearts with his wonderful love. Tonight, if there is anybody here, O God, far away from that great and wonderful love, dear Lord, let that love come to our hearts, Lord. Come to my heart, O God. Jesus. Jesus. Give us that vision of your Calvary's love, Lord, so that our hearts could be melted. Make us like unto thee, O God. We praise and thank you for your sweet presence in this place, Lord. Rest of the service, we commit into your gracious hands in Jesus' name. Thank you. You may please be seated. I know some of you could not come last week. As I did last week, this week, may I also repeat the same asking personal questions, calling your name. Hope it won't be embarrassing to you. But this is only a family, so even if you don't answer, doesn't matter. But when you are conscious that you will be asked a question, you will be more prepared to come to the meeting by refreshing your memory about the study than, you know, without asking the questions. So that is the reason asking questions. I don't expect everybody to answer everything. So if you don't give the right answer, you don't need to be embarrassed about it. But I believe this, whatever we have been studying, can really help our character, for our character development. That is one reason that I would like to ask questions from the last study. Those who did not come last Wednesday, hands up, so that I don't need to ask them. They are so happy to raise the hand, see. So, what is the best thing that we can do when we are ill-treated by others unfairly? When people are ill-treating us unfairly, what the best thing that we could do? That is, Susan, what will you do? And Brother George, take it as a correction. Little more to do, to ask Brother Matthew, Martha. When others are ill-treating us? Yes, and maybe brothers, Sam, Jesse, Sam. Yes, That is what, you know, of course we are studying from the previous chapter. So it doesn't mean that dogmatically this is what you have to do. What they have done, when they were ill-treated by Joseph, or rather by the governor, they were thinking how they ill-treated their brother. Of course, they didn't realize it was Joseph. So when we are being ill-treated by others unfairly, the best thing for us to do, or perhaps one of the best things that we can do, is to think how we ill-treated others. Perhaps we might have ill-treated in a worse way than others are ill-treating us. Then we won't get angry and upset with them. Rather, we will get a spirit to repent about it. And that is, of course, you can open the Bible and, you know, open the Bible and open the notebook. The only thing is that you shouldn't consult with your neighbor, that's all, when the question is being asked. And from the 21st verse, that's what this, the question was from the 21st verse. We read something about, in the 21st verse, we are very guilty concerning our brother. Something about our brother that we mentioned. Anybody can remember that our brother, maybe Laila, our brother. That's right. Well done. Earlier all day, in a hateful way, only the dreamer is coming. They never spoke to him as our brother. So sometimes our troubles that God allows, so that we may get a right relationship with our brother and too. And from the same verse, when he besought us, we would not hear. We read from that. From the 21st verse, the brethren are saying, when he besought us, we would not hear. Therefore is this distress come upon us. Something beautiful that we learned from that. Maybe Shibu? Yes. Well done, well done. That's good. So we'll go to the next verse, 22nd verse. And Reuben answered them, saying, spake I not unto you, saying, do not sin against the child, and you would not hear. Therefore, behold, his blood is required. Last week we learned something. His blood is required. Something we learned. Can Anbu say anything about it? Oh, you are not here. Oh, I see. And then, Brother Mark? About his blood is required from us. Something we learned. Brother Vijay? Brother George from back?
Joseph was not killed, but the intention to kill him was there.
Yes. Yes. Therefore, now they are thinking that their blood will be required from them, or they will be killed. That fear of death was coming upon them. And Reuben, last time we learned about Reuben is standing as Pilate. But in this, it is Reuben is not standing for Pilate, but for something else. That is, Ruby? Yes, our conscience. Our conscience will prick us. No, did not I tell you that when you are about to put that boy to the pit, did not your conscience tell you, don't do that, don't do that? So it will be. It will keep pricking us all along. And 23rd verse. And they knew not that Joseph understood them, for he spake unto them by an interpreter. Something we learned about this from this verse. Maybe Jimmy will know. Why God allows that, you know, that is another question. Can Sister Vanita say? Why God is, you know, from that, something more to add that? Yes, because we are not willing to listen. Therefore, interpreter, another meaning also we heard about the interpreter. perhaps Molly, and so heart. Yes, God does not speak to us plainly, but we read earlier one meaning I mentioned, through the servants of God, God will. You saw through the Holy Spirit. Something else also I told, that we have to remember. Who will remember? Chako will remember? And then, anybody else remembers something else? Yes? Sister Lisa? What? Pardon? Again, say, Jimmy? Yes. So what we learned was that's true. Till we repent about our sins and turn to God, He cannot plainly, directly speak to us. And one meaning I told could be, sometimes God is speaking indirectly through some accidents, dangers, sickness and some problems. Through that also God speaks to us. That can be also, because sometimes interpreters do not do a good work, you know. Only they just give some idea. So sometimes through some accidents and dangers and problems and sickness, God gives any idea. Yes, this is the reason you are getting that. And next verse, that is 24th verse. And he turned himself about from them and wept and returned to them again and communed with them and took from them Simeon and bound him before their eyes. There is something beautiful that we learned, you know, from that. Could be maybe Sister Margaret. Yes. And something else more, Sister Flor? Sister Indira? That's right. Because of our pride and our unrepentant nature, often we can see only the part of Joseph. Joseph was very hard on them. So when our life is not really right with God, we only see the hardness of God. But we don't only see the tenderness of God. How He is weeping that to see that our life is changed, our character is changing. That we don't often see. We only see how God is hard on me, why God is hard on me, why I had to go through this suffering, why God is allowing all these problems. So we see often only one side of the Lord. The other side, His heart is really weeping. And we read also from Lamentation 3:33 that He is not willingly afflict the people of God. He is not willingly. He has no joy in it, but He has to do it reluctantly, as we has to punish our children. Not joyfully, we have to reluctantly do it, otherwise they will not be changed. And the next 25th verse we read something. That is, then Joseph commanded to fill their sacks with corn and to restore every man's money into his sack and to give them provision for the way, and thus did he unto them. Can anybody say anything, Sister Jolie can say out of this verse? Yes, God is doing everything for our own good. That is good. Something more to add, Sister Marikuti? Pardon? Yes. When our life is not right with God, whatever God is doing, we will only see it as bad. Something more we learned. Who can say? Maybe Brother Budra? Can you remember anything that we learned last week from that? We learned that our Joseph, Jesus, provide us daily also to reach Canaan. Enough provision was given for them to reach Canaan. So our Jesus gives us enough spiritual provision to reach our Canaan. What is our Canaan? Heaven. And then the 28th verse, I hope you will remember. What is the meaning of what is this? Manna. What did we learn from that manna? Brother Nitin? What is this? That is our bread. Something more to add? Maybe, Brother Viji? Yes. Every day God gives us manna. Every day to eat. So, that is to make us strong. But some problems, every day God gives. Is there anybody for whom God doesn't give any problem? Hands up. Why God is giving us? That we may become strong, eat this manna, and so that we will be able to reach. Till they went to Canaan, they had manna. After they reached Canaan, no manna. After we reach Canaan, there is no what is this. Everything is will be all right afterwards. Till that time, we will. So we'll go to the next lesson. It's very beautiful to see in type how the, you know, God is, you know, how divine character can be developed in our life through meditating all these things. So from the next verse, we'll start, 29th verse. And they came unto Jacob their father unto the land of Canaan, and told him all that befell unto them, saying, the man who is the Lord of the land spake roughly to us, and took us for spies of the country. And we said unto him, we are true men, we are no spies. We be 12 brethren, sons of our father, one is not, and the youngest is this day with our father in the land of Canaan. And the man, the Lord of the country, said unto us, hereby shall I know that you are true men. Leave one of your brethren here with me, and take food for the famine of your households, and be gone. And bring your youngest brother unto me, then shall I know that you are no spies, but that you are true men. So will I deliver you, your brother, and you shall traffic in the land. What we read here, these brethren, 10 of them, they went back to the father and told all what happened when they went to Egypt and met that strange governor, because they did not realize it was their brother. And here, what are they saying? That governor spoke to us very roughly, you know. And we said, we are true men. So, this is the reason Joseph was speaking roughly. Why? They were telling, now they are telling even to the father. Their father, they are telling, we tried to convince that governor, that man in Egypt, that we are true men. But he had been very rough to us. But we all know, the fact is the other way around. They were not true men. And here they are telling even to the father that we were trying, that we are true men. How long? More than 20 years they were hiding from the father that we are guilty of selling Joseph. Father has been day and night crying and crying and crying. Nobody could console him either. He had kept Joseph's multicolored coat, blood-soaked coat, and crying all the time. Some wild animals might have killed my son. And these very brethren, again they are telling, we are true men, we are true men. What do we learn, dear children of God? Knowing that they are guilty of getting rid of Joseph, they went and told the governor. They did not realize it was Joseph himself. They were trying to justify they were true men. And they were telling even to the father that I tried to tell that man that we are true men. Obviously, they were giving an idea, a picture of themselves to the father also, that we are true men. But they were not. They were cheating. They were deceiving. They practically, in the sight of God, they killed Joseph. Although situations came that they sold him out. And afterwards they are telling they are true men. And they are complaining here that governor has been very rough to us. From here, a beautiful truth we can learn. Sometimes we also act, pretend like that we are true men. We have so much of hypocrisy in our hearts. You and I have so many other things in our life. How we have been deceiving God. We are not true to God. We failed God in so many things. But we may try to put up a picture of ourselves. Before others, we are honest people. We are good people. Whether by testimonies or by my giving a study or the way we act, sometimes we are something inside. We try to show that we are holy, good, spiritual people. This the Lord cannot bear it. In spiritual life, what do you call this character? Something is inside, wrong, but outside you appear to be very good people. Pretend to be good. What do you call? Hypocrisy. This is something that the Lord cannot bear. And that is why our Joseph is rough with us. Often. That is why our Jesus is hard on us. He knows what is in our heart, you know. But instead of telling, Lord, we are not true men. You know all these things. But they are trying to tell the governor and the father that we are true men. And then they couldn't understand why this governor is so rough with us, hard on us. Dear children of God, this is something, number of times in Gospels we read, Jesus departed and went from the hypocrites. He did not leave the sinners and go away any time. He didn't even go away from the backsliders. When Peter was backslidden, he went to the backslider to help him. But he cannot bear the hypocrites. Keeping something inside, a deception and cheating, and show outside to be true men, good people, godly people. That is why they found Joseph is hard. Now I ask you, do you find your life, God is very hard on you? One reason could be, you may be showing outside something, but inside God knows all the rotten things in your heart and in my heart. Often that we read in the Matthew chapter 7, we know that verse, that narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, broad is the way that leadeth unto destruction, many there be that go. But do you know the fact? Of course, in one sense, that is true. But not in all sense. That portion that in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. Enter you in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Jesus is telling, narrow is the way to life. In one sense, that is true. But not in all sense. This particular sermon was preached, this particular portion was not to the disciples. Verse 5, read somebody. Matthew 7, 5. There we find. Yes.
The hypocrite.
That's enough. So, the whole thing that is obviously addressing to the hypocrites. You hypocrites, you do this, you do that, and various things. So, this obviously is to the hypocrites. For hypocrites, this is a hard path. This is the narrow way. Again, I want to tell you, in a general sense, that is true. But I'm telling, strictly speaking, this, thou hypocrite, for you, this is very hard. The path that this Christian life is very, very hard for you. So when our heart is filled with the love of God, then the Bible says, this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome or grievous. When God's love is in our heart, that is, we read in 1 John 5:3, this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous or burdensome. For whom? When the love of God is in our heart, then obeying or coming to church is, some people are not able to come to church or weekday meetings because they find it very hard after all weekdays or all days work. But why do you come? One reason could be because God's love is constraining you. And then you are refreshed by that. So, when God's love is in our heart, then Christian life becomes easier. I don't say it is easy for anyone. But when the love of God is in our heart, is not in our heart, when our heart is filled with hypocrisy, then we find it, everything is hard for us. Therefore, we should desire to be transparent in heart. Let none of us try to show ourselves something outside better when there is inside rotten. We all have so many rotten things in our heart. So many things, when God opens my heart only, I will know so many wickedness. So none of us in the sight of God are justified unless till God justifies us. Next, 35th verse. And it came to pass as they emptied their sacks that behold, every man's bundle of money was in his sack. And when both they and their father saw the bundles of money, they were afraid. Some of the truths we read earlier about it. Money made them afraid. Normally money make them people happy, don't they? Particularly freely money is given, they become so happy. But here, earlier we read they had almost a heart failure. Heart failed, that's what we read anyway. So, here, why the money is making them afraid? Because they sold Joseph and got money. Unrighteously, when money we get, that in the end, the money will be burning our hands. And we will be frightened about that money. Judas Iscariot sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Afterwards, the money was burning in his hands, obviously. He had to throw away the money before he could hang himself. So, one thing that I repeat, dear children of God, we have to be clean about money. Any money that we get unrighteously, one day it will turn out to be a judgment to us. It will appear to be fire burning our hands. Should not have unrighteous income. That is what we find the doctrine of Balaam. For the wages of sin, for cursing, the deceptive way that he wanted to earn money. And it never worked. Anything that we love more than God in the world also, one day it will become a snare. Although God may give us money, if we have unrighteously made money, that money will not be a blessing to us. It will become a burden. These bundles of money became a burden to us. Therefore, burden to them. Therefore, before I go to the next verse, I want to mention, be faithful in money. Because Word of God says, love of money is the root of all evil. We have to be, one man of God says in the Bible, in the New Testament, over 2,000, I think New Testament could be, 2,000 times, or in the whole Bible, I don't remember. Anyway, about faithfulness of money, thousands of times mentioned in the Bible. I forgot somewhere, I have not written it down. But prayer and other things are not mentioned that much. May I ask you, dear child of God, are you really faithful to God in money? Or is there anybody who is robbing God's money? Please don't do so. In the end, it will not do good for you. It will bring conviction to you. And fear in, even when God will bless you with money, you will not take it as a blessing. So please make sure, even if you are to starve, but God's money is God's money. None of us should rob about it. Anyway, we'll go to the 36th verse. From 36 to the end. And Jacob, their father, said unto them, me have you bereaved of my children. Joseph is not, and Simeon is not, and you will take Benjamin away. All these things are against me. And Reuben spake unto his father, say, slay my two sons, if I bring him not to thee. Deliver him into my hand, and I will bring him to thee again. And he said, my son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, and he is left alone. If mischief befall him by the way in the which you go, then shall you bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to the grave. Now, here something. While I was meditating this, I had to confess. This really convicted me. Something that really helped me also to rededicate my life. I hope and pray this will also help you about it. This portion shows the state of a man who goes by feeling, not by faith. Joseph, we can compare in various other places, a man who goes by faith. But here, we find Jacob, a man goes by feeling. What does he say? He says, in effect, in my life, everything is going wrong. Is there anybody like that here? I know you will not raise a hand. What does he say? All these things are against me. Everything is going wrong with me. What is this? Everything is going wrong. That is what he says. All these things are against me. Everything is going wrong for me. So, Those who live by sight or feeling based on circumstances, that they will have one problem that I want to mention. May it go deep into your spirit and my spirit. Those who go by feeling, not by faith in the word of God, the sign of that man is a constant fear haunting that person. All the time fear will be there. That is going to go wrong, this is going to go wrong, and this is already gone wrong, and that matter is going to be also, say, for example, your child is 5 o'clock, child is supposed to come back from school, it is 5:10, and then the devil will put fear. Child must be knocked down by any way. Then phone call comes. You are afraid to go to the phone. It could be police telephoning and saying, so your child is now knocked down and in the hospital. So this way, constantly the fear, it may be your husband is delaying to come, or somebody, something, various day-to-day life, the devil always want to put a negative idea to give. Yes, that is going to go wrong. And this is going to go wrong. And so this way, every time the devil wanted to bring, fear comes through feelings. But when word of God, when we trust in the word of God, then things change. No evil shall befall me, neither shall any plague come nigh my dwelling. He shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. So word of God will really counteract. It will really, challenge that feeling. If we go by feeling, one constant sign of that man who goes by feeling is that constant fear will be there. This man was terribly afraid. All his future is, what does he say? My gray hairs with sorrow you are going to bring down to the grave. I want to tell you, he believed it. How do you know? He believed, obviously, Jacob, he believed that these brothers, his sons are going to bring all the sorrow into his life, and his sorrow will become so much, with all his gray hair, he will go down to the grave. So what did he do? I think he is the only one man. He dug his grave and he was waiting. The Bible says, perhaps he is the only one man who made his own grave, and he had to wait a long time anyway. Over 20 years he had to wait. By the time perhaps the grave that all the mud might have come down and leveled, I don't know. So read about it. Why? He was full of fear. Genesis chapter 5 verse 5. My father made me swear saying, lo, I die. In my grave which I have dug for me, in the land of Canaan, there shalt thou bury me. This is what Jacob told his son. I die in my grave which I have digged for me. What a man Jacob was. He dug his grave and waited. I don't know whether he made his coffin and waited. So he could have finished that work also. Why he made he dug his grave? The reason could be, after I die, there will be nobody to dig the grave for me. So let me do it and finish it. Perhaps that could be the reason. So what we learn from here, dear children of God, when we go by feeling, every little thing, fear will be haunting our life. Perfect love casteth out all fear. And then what you will have, always, just suppose you get a little chest pain, what will you think? It must be a terrible heart attack. And some people even keep so many medicines, expecting a heart attack, giving really a devil welcome, opening the door for it. And any little thing, any pain somewhere in muscles or somewhere, say, the devil will give the worst picture of that. And if you and I keep saying, Amen, Amen, and he will, there is a saying, if you give an inch to the devil, he will take a yard. Oh, so many people are living a miserable life because giving just room for feeling rather than filling with the word of God. When we look at David, when he was going through such a terrible darkness. He didn't say about darkness, I am going through darkness. God is my light. Whom shall I be afraid? And he was, so many troubles were coming. He was telling, through my God, I will run through a troop. That is more than fighting against the troop. So he spoke words of faith. But here is a man we find full of fear. And made his grave and waiting, and everything is going wrong for him. But the fact was not that the other way around. And he says, such people, those who go by feeling, will always self-pity. You look at the self-pity means the self-pity wants to blame others for all our problems. See, what from the verses that we read here, what we read, he says in the 36th verse, me you have bereaved of my children. He's blaming them. And says, you will take Benjamin also away. He's again blaming them. And in the 38th verse says, you bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to the grave. Self-pity will make you will blame others for all your problems. Because of you it's happening to me. Because of you I'm ruined. Modern children also like that. Modern children say, parents, old-fashioned parents, because of them my future is ruined. I cannot be happy. And various other things. They are old-fashioned and if I continue to live with them, they will make my life miserable. All self-pity. And we don't realize when we are blaming whatever problems you face, you try to, husband will blame whom? The wife. Wife will blame the husband. You are the problem. You are the problem. They both will say, you are the problem for all my problem, trials. Jacob was doing that. I remember in one place where I was working, the husband was getting upset and angry with the wife and telling, there is a devil in my husband was raising the hand and there is a devil in you in the name of Jesus. I rebuke you, devil. And she told, there is a big devil in you in the name of Jesus. I don't know what big devil was created by both of them that way. This self-pity will always make others to be blamed, others to be blamed. But real, the true faith, when we live by faith, it is the other way around. We find, yes, I am the hindrance for that. Yes, my faith has to grow. Yes, when such a situation comes, I should have acted in the right way. When we have the right spirit, we take the blame. That is what we read in Isaiah chapter 53. He bore the sin of all and carried it and went to the cross. Isaiah 53 verse 11. There we normally what we try to do with our little wisdom, we want to justify ourselves. But what did Jesus do? In the 11th verse we read, he shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many. Praise God. By his knowledge, my righteous servant justify others. For he shall bear their iniquities. When we bear others' mistakes upon us and pray, that is the real intercession. But normally what people try to do, what with their knowledge, they want to justify themselves and blame others. But Jesus, what he did was the other way around. Self-pity will make that to blame others for all the problems. And here, as we read here, he was blaming his sons for all this unhappiness or problems that came to him. And what did he do? He was telling, my son, 38th verse says, my son shall not go down with you. You know, if you remember the story, when Jacob's brother sons were going to Egypt to buy corn, he did not send Benjamin with them. He had always a constant fear. Benjamin was the youngest one. Earlier, Joseph was sent away and he didn't come back. Now, Jacob says all the 10 brothers to go, but he kept back Benjamin. What was the reason? That we read in 42 verse 4. But Benjamin, Joseph's brother, Jacob sent not with his brethren, for he said, lest peradventure mischief befall him. So he had always a fear. My little son, the last son, some mischief will fall upon him. Who told him that? And therefore, he didn't want to send. He had a fear. And what he feared, that came to him. Now, the governor has sent word with his 10 brethren, unless your youngest brother comes, you are not going to see my face. Now, the brothers went and told the father, now, the governor says the youngest son has to, your youngest son, our youngest brother has to come with us. If he had sent Benjamin with them to the governor, I suppose it would have been quite all right. Joseph might have seen, yes, Benjamin also is safe. That means this brethren have not got rid of the little one. Now, there is a possibility Joseph could naturally think, as they got rid of me, being the youngest out of those 11, perhaps these 10 only came, maybe they might have got rid of Benjamin also. That may be the reason the governor asked, bring your youngest brother. And what we learned from this, when we are haunted by fear, dictated by fear, all what we will do is foolish things. Because he had fear in him, he didn't want to send Benjamin away, thinking there a mischief will take place. And because Benjamin was not sent away, now the problems came. They had to, Simeon is arrested and obviously arrested and kept there in Joseph's place. And now, until Benjamin goes there, he will not be released. So, dear children of God, when we go by feeling and circumstances, rather than by the word of God, fear will constantly haunt us. That is why we have to take hold of the word of God. A word of God says, that no evil shall befall thee. Word of God says, all things work together for good to them that love God. Word of God says, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for them that love him. Word of God says, God will be a wall of fire all around me. So like that, in the times of our problems and distress, if we look to the problem, we will only go down. And there will be no hope at all. But when we look through God, and through the word of God, promises of God, all things work together for good. But Jacob could not understand that. Can you imagine why Jacob was in such a terrible state? Because Jacob, in the eyes of Jacob, Joseph is dead. That is why all this fear. So when we think that our Joseph is dead, who is Joseph? Jesus. Then we also can be in this terrible situation. Not only, according to Jacob, Joseph is not dead and he will never be able to be with him too. Joseph was away from him. Our Joseph, when he is away from our life, we will be like this Jacob. Are there any miserable such Jacobs here? When you think that God is not with you or God is dead, but it's a pity people who know that Jesus is alive, Jesus is with me and in me, how sometimes some people become like this old Jacob. And he says that all these things are against me. This, we already read about self-pity. One of the main reasons of self-pity is fear. Everything is going to go wrong. And when he says all these things are against me, the true fact was that all things were in favor of him, not against him. Jacob, their father, said unto them, me have you bereaved of my children? No, that is not true. None of the children are dead. Really, Joseph is not, he says. That is not true. Joseph not only is alive, he is the prime minister of Egypt. He is going to support them all their life. And Simeon is not. In the eyes of Jacob, Simeon is already dead. No, that was not true. Simeon is there with Joseph there. And you will take Benjamin away. All these things are against me. No, it was not Benjamin is to be taken away as a captive. Benjamin is going to be given a VIP treatment in the palace. And Joseph was waiting for Benjamin to come, not to be as a captive. So he says, all these things are against me. When Jacob was mentioning, all these things are against me, all these things were in favor of him. How many Jacobs are here who often say, everything is going wrong with me? I don't know why it's happening like that. But that is through the feeling. But if we look through faith, everything is working out beautifully for us, for good only. But we need the eyes of faith to see that. Later on we read about, Jacob, after, once he came to know that Joseph was alive, all these things really changed. It became glorious. And see how he became, in a selfish way he speaks here. In the 38th verse, he said, my son shall not go down with you. He says, my son, rather than mentioning, it is your brother also. So, he is singling out Rachel's children here. Rachel had two children, Joseph and Benjamin. 38th verse says, he said, my son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, he is left alone. If mischief befall him by the way in that which you go, then shall you bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to the grave. But do you know, dear children of God, the end of Jacob, finally he was able to realize all what Jacob thought was wrong. And end of Jacob, what happened end of Jacob, or even well before, 17 years before his death, he realized Joseph was alive. He was able to go to Joseph. Then what are the beautiful things happen? His life was really changed. Afterwards, there was a great change in Jacob. So what we need to emphasize, or when we realize our Jesus is alive, and fairly soon afterwards, Jacob went to stay with Joseph, then things changed. Even while dying, Jacob was able to bless all his children. So, the end became better. How? From the time Jacob knew that Joseph was alive, then we don't need to go by feeling. And I don't know, some time ago, Brother Gihan, I listened to the cassette, spoke a beautiful sermon here about the staff, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. He was speaking about the staff, means the promises of God. Now, we read about Jacob, so many things, the wrong things. He is a man full of self-pity, blaming others for all his problems. He is full of fear. He had a negative mind. Everything is going to go wrong. And it will continue to go wrong. And he made his own grave. And he was waiting to go to the grave. And almost he was in a cursing way. May you have bereaved of my children. As if all his children are dead and gone. Such a man, dear children of God. That, as you might have heard about, Brother Gihan mentioning beautifully, that he was in Hebrews chapter 11, we read about Jacob as something beautiful. His name has come, in fact, in heroes of faith, in the list of the heroes of faith. What is the greatest thing that he had done here, as if something very great? So many people that we find, they stopped the mouth of the lions and offered Isaac on the altar, and walls of Jericho fell down, and so many beautiful things, heroic things done by so many heroes of faith mentioned, but about Jacob, all what we read is in Hebrews 11:21. Somebody may read 11:21.
By faith Jacob, when he was a dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph and worshipped, leaning upon the top of his staff.
See, what is mentioned, the greatness mentioned about this man of God was, he was leaning on the staff while dying. What is the meaning of the staff? Promises of God. Actually, that is what really make you and me heroes, heroes of faith. What should we do? We should lean on the promises of God. That makes all the difference. There is, it may appear, why this man's name has come? All what we read here is, he worshipped, he blessed while dying. He was leaning upon the top of his staff. It's written as if something very great thing. But spiritually speaking, that is very great thing. What is that very great thing? That while dying also, we should lean on the promises of God. Some people may lean on the promises of God while alive, but while dying, they give up the faith. They give up the whatever the promises God has given. And while dying, trusting in God, trusting in the promises of God is greater than while living, trusting in the promises of God. For example, Word of God very clearly says, I am the Lord that healeth thee. With his stripes we are healed. These are the promises of God. People, when they have got some little headache or sickness, they will be able to trust in the promise of God. Yes, I believe. But what we read about Jacob, while dying, he was leaning on the promises of God. While dying, trusting in the promises of God, yes, I still believe Jesus is my healer. I still believe his word I want to trust. But some people, God forbid, let it not happen to you or to me. While living, or when there is no serious sickness, they will trust in the promises of God. Trust in divine healing. But while dying, they give up and rush to the hospital and try to die there. That is not a heroic action, dear children of God. While dying also, one day of course you and I will die if the Lord tarries. But this man, what was the blessing? While leaning on the top of his staff, what did he do? While dying also, he was worshipping God. And while dying also, what did he do? He was blessing his children. Some people, while dying, they become a burden to the children. But a man who is leaning upon the promises of God, I think it's good that we all may read together verse 21. It is beautiful. Hebrews chapter 11, 21. This really blessed my heart. We will all read together. Hebrews 11:21. While reading, let our heart pray, Lord, I want my life also. This verse should be fulfilled in my life also. With that prayer, let us read together. Shall we all? By faith, Jacob, when he was a dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph and worshipped, leaning upon the top of his staff. Praise be to God. While dying, by faith, he blessed. Actually, he did not only bless the sons of Joseph. 49th chapter of Genesis says he blessed all his children. One by one, naming them, he blessed all his children. And he worshipped. All this he did, leaning upon the top of his staff, leaning on the promises of God. And how Jacob's life was changed? Because he saw Joseph alive. And the last 17 years of his life, he was with Joseph. The first 17 years of Joseph was with Jacob. I hope you will realize, remember, when Joseph was 17, he had to leave the house. So the first 17 years of Joseph's life, he was with Jacob. The last 17 years of Jacob's life was with Joseph also. Let the end be better than the beginning, as in Ecclesiastes we read. That also we should claim. In all these blessed promises of God, we should trust. So while dying, because he was leaning upon the top of his staff, he was a blessing. I remember some time ago, in a particular, in London church, I would say, some time ago, one brother died. Before dying, he was rushed to the hospital, and he died and he was buried. He had an unsaved son. His unsaved son was very sorry about his father dying. That's all. He continued to be unsaved, and he won't come to church. But 2 months ago, the mother died. Mother, before dying, she decided she wanted to trust in the Lord and die. And the pastor in charge there and sister and all, they went and they were singing and praising God. And peacefully that mother passed into glory. And this by the time he is no more a boy now, he's a young man. And this touched this boy. From that day he's completely changed. He started coming, the family comes only for the weekend meetings. He started coming for every meeting. He straight away gave his heart to the Lord. His mother's death really spoke to him. And Easter Sunday before last, he took water baptism too. So, the way that mother died trusting in the Lord, that touched him, his heart and changed him. And through that he was really blessed. But when father died, nothing could change him. So, I don't mean to say simply, just where you are dying alone will be the greatest thing. No. In what state we are dying, that matters. Whether we are, I ask you a question, do you really have a desire? Suppose the Lord tarries, we may all die one day. How do you want to die? That's all depending upon your heart's desire, God will fulfill. None of you, your riches or glory or money cannot guarantee how you are going to die. Jacob's death was so glorious. Not only that, that is recorded in Hebrews chapter 11. Not anywhere else. Oh, of course, other place also we read, but not so clearly like this. His name has come in the heroes of faith. While dying, he was leaning upon the top of his staff. While dying also we should lean upon the promises of God. And the staff, if it is standing for the promises of God, the top of the staff stands for the greatest and the most glorious promises of God. The top, he was leaning upon the top of the staff. So we should lean, trust the greatest, the glorious, most glorious promises of God. And that will be a blessing. While dying also he was blessing. As Jesus, while dying also he was a blessing. Even the very thief got saved that was next to him. And even the seeing the death, even the centurion told, this must be a righteous man. The very death spoke. And while Jesus was going ascending to heaven also, we find with two hands he was blessing and going up. Dear children of God, that is what you and I need to have. Your last minutes, how it should be, although it is in the hands of God, it will depend upon our heart's desire and sincere motive in our heart. And therefore, we find, as I told you, while dying, leaning, unless we are willing to die, and that another beautiful truth that we read is that while dying he was leaning upon the top of his staff. Another spiritual meaning, I hope you will remember, every day we have to be dying to lean on the top of the staff. If your self is still dominating your life, if your ego and my ego is still dominating your life, I cannot lean on the top of the staff. I hope you understand what I mean to say. While dying, he was leaning upon the top of his staff. So every day we should be willing to die to ourselves, our will, and our old man. Then only we will be able to lean on the promises of God. What a beautiful life. Dear child of God, when whether resurrection or rapture, the last should be better than the beginning. Of course, rapture, we know it will be glorious. Suppose tomorrow death will, or tonight death will take place, or you are going to die. What are you planning to do that time? They throw the promises of God out of the window. Oh, I don't want to trust in God. Rush to hospitals. And by the way, I want to tell again, whether I will trust in the Lord divine healing, I cannot myself be confident and boastful about it. Suppose I am knocked down on the way tonight on the road and unconscious I become, and somebody will take me to the hospital, and nothing can be done. Unless God keeps, we cannot keep ourselves. Unless we desire that God has to keep us, how can God keep us? That God cannot. One of our pastors in Trichur in Kerala, he, number of people in the bus accident, they died. And in that, they thought that this pastor servant of God also dead. So in the mortuary, along with all the dead bodies, this pastor's dead body in courts also was taken there. And they put some white sheets on top. So many dead bodies were there. And one of the nurses there was one of our believers. She saw only just a part of the foot of the pastor. Because of the kneeling down, you know that there is a hard skin there right on the ankle. That was seen. Then he realized, she realized, this must be our pastor. And looked. That was true. It was our pastor. And he is not dead. He was still breathing. Because they thought number of dead bodies were there. So this nurse told, she had to give in writing, I take the responsibility, and not to give any medicine, no, nothing, because we will take to the faith home. Faith home was informed, and she took, you know, as you all know that, you have to give in writing. And God completely healed him afterwards. After about 20 years only, he died later on. So it is God who can keep. But one thing, if God has to keep, you have to entrust your life to him. I know whom I believe, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I entrusted unto him against that day. Have you entrusted your last minute to the hands of God? I ask you again, have you entrusted your last minute into the hands of God? Or do you want it should be in the hands of the doctors and the medicines and the injections and the nurses and the curtains and the oxygens and the pumps running here and there? What you decide, that only God can. I know whom I believe, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which entrusted unto him against that day. If God has to keep you, you have to give yourself into the hands of God. And although we read so many things, negative things about Jacob, he was full of self-pity, haunted by fear, blaming others for all his problems. He was telling everything is going against me and all things are going wrong. He was miserable, and he was trying to make others' lives miserable, and he dug a grave, and he was waiting for that, and he was blaming that, you know, all this brother, his sons are going to force him to the grave. All these things. Thank God. Once he realized Joseph is alive, and he went and stayed with him, lived with him. The last years of his life, it was always with Joseph. Dear children of God, that should be our desire. And afterwards, he never parted from Joseph. We should be like that. And I tell you, while it is worth living for Jesus, and if it is worth living for Jesus, it is worth dying for Jesus too. There is a right saying, if the truth that you stand for, if it is not worth dying for, it is not worth living for. Dear children of God, I challenge you. If God can change Jacob to be such a tremendous blessing, his name could come in the heroes of faith. And as word of God says, while dying, he leaned on top of the staff. That should, tonight you should make the decision. Lord, by the grace of God, I want to lean not in the middle of the staff. I want to lean on the top of the staff. The highest, the most glorious promises of God. I want, Lord, I want to lean upon them. For that, what we have to be we have to do one thing. While dying, he was leaning. Are you willing to die to your own unbelief today? Are you willing to die to your own plans? Are you willing to die to your own principles and your own imaginations and intellectual knowledge? Are you willing to give up all those things? While dying, he was leaning on the staff, on top of the staff, and he blessed everybody. God doesn't want you and I to be a burden. That is what I also pray. Lord, if you tarry, and if I to come to the out of this world, Lord, I don't want to go from this world with sickness. Pastor S.B. Ernester very often taught that divine healing means divine death. You don't need sickness. Even while dying also, God can heal. Ante, you may know several people like that. Before dying, God healed them and God took. So, healing is not only while we are healthy and strong, even before dying also God can do. Whether we are healed or not, our decision should be like Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. My God is able to deliver me out of this fiery furnace. But even if he doesn't deliver me, yet I am not going to worship all those bells, idols. Yet I am not going to give up my faith. As Job, that is beautiful about Job. Maybe we will read that and we will finish. Time is up. Job 13, first of all we will read verse 4. But you are forgers of lies. You are all physicians of no value. Some people say this, it may be because his miserable comforters might have brought some physicians, doctors, we don't know. But you are forgers of lies. You are all physicians of no value. Of course, for God's people, this is applicable. For sinners, physicians are good. Physicians and nurses and medicine, that's doing a good job. But for God's people, as we read all through the Bible, one thing is very clear. In the Bible, please listen this, you will see no saint ever used medicine. Backsliders used Bible mentions. For example, King Asa, when he was in a backsliding state, then when he became sick, and sickness became serious, and second Chronicles chapter 16, we read about, there's no time to read, when he became very sick, instead of seeking God, he sought after the physicians, and then 2 more years he remained in bed and died in the 41st year of his reign. Word of God says. And we don't see his name in the Hebrews chapter 11. None of the people, and even 2 Kings chapter 1, we read, when another king became sick, instead of seeking God, he sought after somebody else. Then the word of God came through a man of God. Because you did not seek God, but sought after somebody else, you will not come out of your bed. Bible says. Hezekiah, in his sickness, he sought God, not physicians. The Lord told, 15 years more I am adding to you. So all through the Bible, dear children of God, never a saint took medicine. Backsliders have taken. Unbelievers have taken. And the first place that we read in the Bible that's very interesting. When was the doctor was used? Physician, doctor was called to attend upon? Genesis chapter 50 verse 5. My father made, 50 verse 2. And Joseph commanded his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father. And the physicians embalmed Israel. That is the first place in the Bible. Physicians were used. What was the... physicians were called for whom? For the dead. Not for the living. Anyway, what I wanted to say, don't take it as our doctrine. It is the word of God. I will read out an Assemblies of God man, a famous pastor called Harold Houghton, Assemblies of God, Nottingham. Medicine and surgery is the world's way. It's the world's way. God's way, the only way revealed in the word, is healing by supernatural divine power. These two ways are entirely opposed. True. Many real Christians resort to the way of the unbeliever. But that does not alter the fact that it is the way of the unbeliever. Divine healing is the only healing authorized by the scriptures. Another man of God, Assemblies of God, AOG, man again, you all know, Smith Wigglesworth, his words, not from recollection only I wrote this. If you can't believe that God can heal your sickness while alive, how can you believe that your body can be raised to life when Jesus comes after you are dead and buried and decomposed and gone? So, he says, when you are sick, if you cannot believe Jesus can heal you, after you are dead and your body is all rotten and gone, how can you believe that body can be raised by the power of God? Now, the little sickness, you don't believe that the God's power cannot heal. And look at Job. This should be the right decision that we have to make. Job 13, again, the verse 15. Shall we read it together? Job 13, verse 15, 1-5. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him, but I will maintain my own ways before him. That is the right decision. Earlier, Satan told, you gave all the benefits to him, you try to touch his body, then he is going to deny you. That is what some believers do. When their body is touched, they don't want to trust God. Then Satan will be very happy, isn't it? Satan told the Lord, why Job is worshipping you? Because you gave everything comfortably. You take it away. And finally told, you touch his body, then you will see whether he will trust you or not. Whether he will forsake or not. God allowed him. Then all over his body, with portrait, she started scratching. Even his wife told, you better forsake God and die. Curse God and die. When body was touched, then also he decided, yes, I am going to trust God. Though he slays me, yet will I trust in him. And I will maintain my own ways before him. Dear child of God, over 3,000 years ago, Job made that decision. That time Jesus did not die on the cross. That time it was not written, with his stripes you are healed. That had not come. That time, in Exodus, because the Bible scholars say this book was written first, before even any other book. The oldest book in the Bible is Job, although it is almost in the middle. There's even that verse, I am the Lord that healeth thee, was not, anyway, there was no Bible that time, in Job's time. That time he decided, though he will slay me, yet will I trust him. As I am closing my words, with Jacob, how many of you also want to make that decision? Jacob, by faith, while dying, he was leaning on the top of the staff and blessed and worshipped. He blessed his sons and worshipped. And that verse came to the word of God. While dying, also, shall we all stand up? I know our life and death is in the hand of God. Where you will die, where I will die, where you will be buried, I will be buried, we do not know. But one thing we can make sure, I know whom I believe and persuaded that he is able to keep that which I entrusted into against that day. Dear child of God, do you really want to lean on the top of the staff? Not only now, even the last moment of your life. It is like almost a spiritual will you are writing tonight. My last moment should be trusting in God. My last moment should be believing in the promises of God. My last moment should be entrusting my spirit, soul and body also into the hands of God. How many of you really want to lean on the top of the staff? And worship the Lord. How many of you really want to trust the promises of God? Even the moment comes, a dying moment comes, trusting in God, in divine healing. As Job told, even if he will slay me, but I will trust him. But I tell you, he doesn't slay anybody. The thief cometh, he is only killing and slaying. I have come to give life and life more abundant. Now I would like you all to please close your eyes. I again tell you, where I will die, when I will die, all in the hands of God. But one thing you can do, you can just lean on the top of the staff. And even while dying, God is able to do that for you. Every day there should be a death to our own ideas and plans. Are you willing to die for the truth? In every age there should be some martyrs also for the truth, trusting in the divine healing, willing to give up all the physicians and doctors and medicines. And if you like Jacob, you want to lean upon the top of the staff, may I request you before closing, just come forward and stand. And I tell you, even if you are a person weak in faith, God will honor you. Jake, I don't think there is anybody so weak as Jacob was. He was so miserable, man of self-pity. But God changed. But one thing I want to assure you, if you trust in God, even while dying, you will not be a burden to anybody. You will not be a burden to your wife. You will not be a burden to your husband. You will not be a burden to your children. You will not be a burden to your parents. You trust in the Lord and see that God is good. Let's pray. Anybody wants to come, you can come and stand. Even if you don't have any faith, as the father of the child told Jesus, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. But I tell you, surely you can become a blessing. Even while dying, you can be a blessing. Perhaps Jesus may come tonight. God will give you grace. Hallelujah. Shall we all pray? Jesus. Everyone make the decision. Lord, I want to lean upon the top of the staff. The highest promises of God I want to trust. Jesus. Shall we all pray together? Jesus. 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 Father, life is Lord in your hands, O God. Help me, O God. Help every one of us, O God. Help every one of us, O God. O God, help every one of us, O God, to trust in the promises of God, O God. O Jesus. Lord, let the end become better than the beginning, O God. Let the end become better than the beginning, O God. Jesus, Jesus. Let's all get filled with the Holy Spirit. God will give a new faith. My God, Jesus, in the name of Jesus, anoint everyone, oh God, anoint everyone, oh God, oh God, help everyone to know, lean upon, hallelujah, 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 lean on His arms, trusting in His love, lean on His arms, all His name is lean on His arm, looking home about, just lean on the same song.
God is on, trusting in His love, lean on His arm, always with me through. Oh, Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Not only while alive, but even while dying also, if the Lord tarries, God may help us to lean on the promises of God. Whether we live or die, help us to lean on the top of the promises, of highest promises of God. Shall we lift up the hands and praise God for that? Hallelujah. Praise you, God. Hallelujah. Praise you, God. Praise you, God. Praise you, God. Hallelujah. 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 If the Lord tarries, if we die,
Señor tarda.
We should not be a burden
morimos,
to others, but a blessing.
No debemos de ser una carga para otros, sino una bendición.
If you go by feeling, you can be a burden,
si
but
usted,
if you go by faith, you will be a blessing.
Si usted va por sentimiento, entonces
shall we praise God for that? Oh, hallelujah. Praise you, praise you, praise you, praise you. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise you, God. Praise you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.